everybody. Welcome to another episode of Blue Collar Real Estate. I'm Greg Mayo.
And I am Ryan Herget. Greg, I know you've got some cool stories to tell. Plus, we've also had some people reach out since we have been rolling with this podcast now for a few months, so we're starting to get some questions. What's cooking?
We are, and funny you should say what's cooking, because the question this week comes from Erwin F. Fletcher.
Erwin Fletcher?
Erwin Fletcher. He goes by Fletch. And he asks, when dealing with stewed prunes, is 4 too many or is 3 not enough?
Stewed prunes.
Yeah.
Man, again, you just so caught me off guard with that one. This is going back to like when we first started the podcast, and our sponsors were these companies it was very comical, but the first couple you really caught me off guard with. You've accomplished the same. Well done.
Well, that's my goal.
Well done, Fletch.
The answer, Fletch, is that when dealing with stewed prunes, it depends. Are you making a pie, a cobbler, a flambe, or a souffle? Let me know, and we'll get back to you. Anyway.
Moving on. Greg, what? So you've spent some time in Chicago here lately.
I have.
And you've got another story that you've got to share with everybody because, A, it's awesome, and secondly, it's pretty funny.
Dude. So my wife and I are in Chicago. And the whole thing about this excursion was just to get passports, right?
Right.
Which is a blindingly insane process. But everybody at the passport office, by the way, super awesome.
That's cool.
They could not have been cooler people. But so we go through the process, and then they tell us, come back in 3 hours and pick up your passport. And we're like, well, it's cold and we're in Chicago. What do we do? We get on our phones and look, and we take a lift over to the Skydeck building. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go up, and we're going to look out and do the whole thing. So we get in there, and it's confusing as hell, this building, the way it's laid out. We get in there, we get off on the wrong elevator, and there's some guy, some older guy, and he goes, hey, what we doing over here? What are you looking for? And I said, okay, this is a good opportunity.
Yeah, this is going to be fun.
Because he's got this real thick Chicago accent. I'm some yuck from Indiana, so I went, well, what we're trying to do is get up there. You know that platform up there on top of this building here where, it's clear and you can see down there? What are we trying to get up there? He said, oh, the sky deck. Okay, what you got to do to get to the sky deck? You got to go down this elevator here, and then you go across over there, and you go up these stairs. You go in, you get your ticket, boom, you're upstairs. You know what I'm saying?
Just like boom.
It's boom. And I continuing on with it, because at this point, my wife's rolling her eyes. Continuing on with it, I said, well, ain't that the darndest thing, honey? To get up to the top of this here building, we got to go downstairs in this here building. Go over there, go up some more stairs, apparently to another building. That's just crazy right there. I can't even tell you. And the guy's like rolling his eyes, and he's like, all right, you too. You have a good day. And I said, you too there, partner. We'll see you. Thanks for your help. I don't know if that was Ross Perot or T. Boone Pickens or what the hell that was.
We'll go with a combination of both.
The American people are sick and tired. Anyway.
How many people you think listening to this, speaking of Ross Perot, like I remember like the campaign of, it was 92, right? When Ross is campaigning, and I so clearly remember him because he spoke so distinctly, mm-hmm. and it was so different than anything I had heard at the time. So how many people do you think listeners out there we have to actually still know who that is?
I don't know. I mean,
this was a while ago now.
Yeah, they got to be our age or older.
Right.
But he would say the funniest stuff, you know. Dennis Miller called him a hand grenade with a crew cut, and that's what he was. But he would say stuff like, now, if you're going to make fudge, you can't put chickens and bacon in the barn. I'm just telling you, people. And his supporters would be like, yeah, you know.
Like the gospel spoken right there.
I loved Ross Perot. I'll tell this story some other time, but being able to do his voice, George Bush's voice, and Clinton's voice got me through a political science presentation I wasn't prepared for.
I'm going to digress real quick, then we'll get on with the rest of the show, which we're going to talk about. Should you sell your house or should you rent the house? Do you want to be a landlord or do you just want to get the heck out of Dodge and sell that thing and put some money in your pockets? We're going to talk about that in a second. And the funniest comedian I've ever like seen live was Frank Caliendo. And he did probably one of the best George W. Bush impressions at the time. And you do really, really good impressions, like so well that I'm always laughing. And my wife's like, similar to yours, like, oh my gosh, what are these guys laughing at? But I think it's funny. And oh yeah, I would love to have witnessed that debate going on that you had there in that speech. I bet that was pretty epic.
Yeah, that was good stuff. and before we get into it, we're also going to talk about Airbnb. An option.
I'm super excited about that.
But we have to talk about our sponsor, of which we actually have.
We do have.
Stacy Mayo and the Scott Miller team at Ruoff Mortgage.
They did. They came on board a few weeks back with us, and it's really been a cool partnership so far because we've been doing a lot of additional work with them. You know, we've been getting, you know, getting together in their office and doing some more training with our agents, making some calls together, and really just leveraging the relationship to help all of our, you know, work move forward. And they do such awesome work, I feel.
They do, and they've been a big help to our two newest agents.
Oh my gosh, gigantic.
And they've been a big help to deals. I'll just share this story. I'll tell it myself. I had a deal going where my guy was selling a house and buying another one. Mm-hmm. The person buying the house said, appraisal's done. You guys want to close early? And I got excited and excited for my guy. And I said, I don't know. I'll ask him. I said, do you want to close early? He said, sure. I got to the listing agent at the other house. You guys want us to close early? Sure. The house is empty. We're all going to close early. Woo! Scheduled both closings with title, went through the whole process. And then Stacy at Ruoff sent me a message and said, hey, you want to let me know before you agree to close early? And I was like, oh.
Oh, yeah.
You sorry.
People. You people.
I said, totally my fault. Let me get a hold of everybody. And she said, no, let me see what I can do. Their team, their assistant, the underwriting department, everybody jumped on it with both feet. And by the end of the day, I had an answer. Yep, we can close early.
And that's one thing if you're shopping for a mortgage, this is something I cannot, emphasize more, is the importance of working with absolute professionals when you're going through something that is the business of real estate. When you're buying a house, which is expensive, emotional, and you don't do it very often, which you combine those three things, it creates a lot of drama sometimes. You have to have a team of great people on board in order to make things like that happen. Because if you don't, man, all hell breaks loose and it ends up pissing everybody off and frustrating people. But when you have the right team of people that have that mindset that they do, that Stacy does at Ruoff, and almost everybody does at Ruoff. I mean, I've yet to talk to one person over there that doesn't adopt this philosophy of all hands on deck. It is, let's accomplish the goal and let's exceed expectations.
And could you imagine if they wouldn't have jumped on it and fixed it, me having to call back both other agents and my client and the title company, I make all these phone calls and eat crow every single time.
Right. That's not fun.
So instead, they saved me and made me look good, which is fantastic.
That's what it's about. That's what it's all about. So let's dive into real quick, not real quick, but let's kind of take a deep dive into that. You know, maybe you do have a house to sell. You know, you were just telling the story of, your client that, was selling a house and buying another one. Is that the best option right now? Because we're in a real estate market where, especially here in central Indiana, where there's many parts of town that have seen 10% year-over-year appreciation, which is real money. One investor that's not boasting about getting 10% returns. Well, when you buy a house, and again, this could change at some point in the future, as of recording this in February of 2020, we're on a 7 to 8 year just meteoric rise in value. And maybe that'll continue. Hopefully it does. But at some point, it's got to slow down. But regardless, owning a home is truly an investment. And for a lot of people, they've decided to go ahead and hold on to that asset and turn it into an income producing property. And there's so many new cool ways you can do that besides just the traditional putting a tenant in there and hoping they don't suck and blah, blah, blah.
Right.
So we're going to take a deep dive into that. But we also have to explore the flip side of that same coin is, man, I can tell you firsthand, being a landlord is not for everybody. It is 100% not for everybody. And I've got some very negative stories. My brother and I were buying a lot of properties back in the early 2000s. And man, I got burned on two people in a row. They ended up costing me a lot of money because I was trying to be a landlord and actually do it all myself because I was smart and knew everything at that time in my life.
Right.
I don't need a property manager. I got this, right? But if that's a direction that you do want to go, we're going to talk a little bit about what do you need to consider and maybe some skills that you need to have if continuing to own that home and turning it into an income-producing property is right for you.
And the confluence of events that brought us to this topic, having met with Airbnb management companies, I've helped my son's piano teacher rent a few properties or get people in and going through that process. And then I had a client who a couple of years ago, I helped her sell her home and helped her buy a condo downtown. Absolutely one of my favorite clients ever. She's so cool. Just a neat lady. She texted me the other day and says, hey, I think I'm going to take a job in Florida. Now, the first thing was, do you know any agents in Tampa? Mm-hmm. And of course, being with EXP, I know agents all over the country.
Absolutely.
And in Canada and New Zealand. But anyway, so she reached out and I said, yeah, let me hook you up with a guy down there I know. And I did. And then we started talking about, she wanted to, well, do you think I should keep my condo and rent it or sell it? Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of questions I needed answers to that she had to tell me where she was mentally, emotionally, so far and so on, before I could answer that question. And I thought, I bet there's a lot of people with that those questions.
No doubt. No doubt. And, you know, especially when it's so hard to get a house bought right now. I mean, and, you know, I mean, you can literally take a house that's maybe $220,000 here in central Indiana right now in the climate that we're in, and you can have 10 offers on that thing in the first 24, 48 hours.
Yeah, easy.
It's insane. So selling a house is not necessarily very, you know, very challenging right now. And it's also very attractive because when, you know, we were telling a story on a previous episode of a lady that's owned a home 7 years, and after spending $20,000 on repairs to this house, is still going to walk away with, you know, just south of $50,000, you know, which is the equivalent of the yearly, you know, the average median income in the state of Indiana. I mean, that's a huge amount of money that you put in your pocket just for continuing to live in a house, which you have to do anyway, or live somewhere,
right?
Pay rent or pay a mortgage. And when home values go up, yeah, that's certainly attractive. And a lot of people will use that as their nest egg. You know, that's the money they have set aside. Hell, I know and work with a lot of people that they don't necessarily have a big retirement set up, but they've got a hell of a lot of equity in their house. Mm-hmm. And that's exciting. That's exciting because it's an opportunity to position yourself and your family in a better spot financially.
So let's take the example of my client, Lena.
Yeah.
She has a condo downtown. It's a 3-bedroom, 2-bath condo with a 2-car garage attached.
Mm-hmm.
It's a townhouse kind of vibe. Downtown Indy.
It's hot.
And she's not had it that long, but I ran the comps and she could make a profit even after a year and a half or whatever it's been.
That's insane. It really is. I mean, after paying all the costs of selling a house, it's not uncommon at all to still walk away with $10,000, $15,000 right now in your pocket. I've got story after story like that, but anyway, go ahead.
And so she could sell it and make some money. She's going to, again, down to Florida. The Gulf Coast, which I'll be someday.
Soon.
I think I'm going to, on a side note, I think I'm going to buy a pirate ship. Me and a buddy of mine were talking about this. We're taking sailing classes this summer.
I like that idea.
And when I retire, my job's going to be ferrying people from St. Petersburg down to Key West and back on my pirate ship.
On a pirate ship.
Yeah.
Man, that sounds so awesome. How many people would pay to do that?
I think it'd be boss.
We could talk about that for the next 30 minutes, but let's digress.
All right, so back to the thing. Yeah, sorry.
So your client that's moving down there, should she sell this condo or should she just rent it out
right. And
continue to hold on to that asset?
So we talked about the money she could make now, walk-away money. We also talked about the challenges and opportunities of being a long-distance landlord,
mm-hmm.
which there are many.
Many.
And then you and I both, I'm not going to mention them, they're not sponsors of the show yet, but there's a property management company here in Indy that does a great job.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's several, I'm sure.
Many of them, yeah.
But there's one for sure that I've used many times. I've never gotten anything but positive feedback about it. Now, you can turn that responsibility over to a property management company, but then you got to pay for that.
See, and I think that's something we've really got to dive into for a few minutes on this subject, is because that's one of those factors that you have to take into consideration. And it's funny that you actually bring that up, because I got a text just yesterday from a gentleman that we helped buy a new home last year, ended up keeping it. What are you laughing at? what's going on here?
The pirate thing, a joke through my head.
We're still stuck on the pirate thing. So this guy texts me yesterday, Justin's his name. He texts me yesterday and he's frustrated as all can be because he's got this rental property. I can't take you seriously right now. I can't take you seriously. If you're watching on YouTube, I encourage you to turn off the radio at this point and just hit the fast forward thing like 30 seconds on your phone and fast forward on your podcast here. So Justin texts me. Will you stop? Oh God, that's funny. Jason's back there taking pictures of us right now. So nevertheless, okay. Justin texts me. He's pissed off because he spends all. Whoever said laughing is not contagious, right? I'm gonna just keep talking and not look at you right now. I'm gonna look at the screen. What's up, Jason? So he texts me, and he's trying to manage this property on his own. Okay, he's holding on to this property for all the reasons we've talked about, as I'm not looking at Greg anymore right now. And he literally spent all day at this house dealing with toilet problems, dealing with a water softener that is not functioning properly, which has created all these problems because his home's on a well, right?
Oh, wow.
And it's like he is pulling his hair out. He texts me last night, and he's like, F it, I'm over all this. And I'm like, just let's whoa back here, son, and let's find a solution. It definitely is there. But that's an example of a challenge that you have to take on if you're a property manager, or I'm sorry, if you're a homeowner and you're trying to do this on your own.
Right.
You better have some time. You better have some, like, I can fix it skills, right? And you better have some, you know, financial ability to take care of some of those problems. So like you were saying in a previous episode, you know, you don't have mushrooms growing in your bathroom because not all tenants take care of things like they possibly should. So there's certainly pros and cons that come with that. But I think one of the things is when you, just like anything in business, right? When you put the right team of people around you, like in this case, a great property manager, it takes that off your plate so you can go do what you do well. Okay. I'm not a home repair guy. I know enough to be dangerous. And yes, I can fix a roof, but man, it's a lot easier for me to pay somebody a couple hundred dollars to go and fix that roof. And that way I know it's done the right way.
Yep.
So I have to put myself up on a roof, go buy special shoes, go buy a bundle of shingles, go buy all the tools that I need to do this, and then take a couple hours when it should take me 15 minutes. Those are things that you just have to take into consideration if you're going to choose to manage your own property. There's pros and cons, again, that come with both sides of that. But, you know, I certainly feel at this point in my life, hiring a property manager that knows what they're doing, that has good processes and systems to make sure that you have a good experience, that you vet your tenant the right way so that way you don't get an asshat tenant in there that's going to destroy the property. And, of course, you can never guard all the way against that. But there's certainly precautions that you can take, background checks that you can do to make sure that you put yourself in the best possible situation to succeed.
But if you're not used to doing that, those are look at the questions we just threw out there that if you're not used to doing it, you don't have the answers to. How do I find renters?
Right.
How do I vet them? Where do I find a lease?
Truly, yeah. Where do you get a lease at? I mean, yeah, you can Google anything, but does that whatever you just Googled adhere to your state laws?
Right. And that, or does it adhere to your HOA restrictions if you have it?
Oh my gosh, that's a big one.
What if I have to toss them out? How does that work?
Well,
those are a lot of things that a property management company already knows the answers to, because that's what they do all day, every day.
And those are things that if you don't know the answers to those things before you get started, either A, you're going to learn through the school of hard knocks, which we all do to some degree, right? But secondly, it's going to cost you money. Okay, because if you don't know how to get somebody out of your house and what the laws are around that, you can't just say, I need you out by tomorrow or I need you out by the end of the month. Because guess what? There's people that know how to play that game and they know what the laws are as tenants and they can make it super, super challenging. In Indiana, it's a super tenant-friendly state. It can take you 3 months to get somebody out if you don't have the right steps in place up front to get it done.
Right.
How do I know that? Because I learned that the hard way, because I knew everything when I was 25 years old and I got this. Just ask me. I would tell you about it at that time in my life. But you couldn't be more spot on with that. You have to have not only a good property manager, you have to know how to make repairs, right? You have to know, where do I get the right documentation to do this the right way to protect your tail at the end of the day?
And so you may look at all that. You may look at the percentages a property management company takes and you may think, I don't have the stomach for this. I just want to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the right agent will help you figure out how much money you'll likely make and how much money you should sell it for. So you go in with that information armed and you have an understanding, I'm going to make this cash. Maybe you're going to roll it into another house you're buying. Maybe that helps with the down payment.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you want to buy a pirate ship.
Right?
I don't know.
Who doesn't want to buy a pirate ship?
But and there's ways to get that money and ways that you can do it without and avoid capital gains taxes. We are not real estate attorneys or accountants, so we don't know. But consult with somebody on that. But we can help you figure out the likely profit.
Absolutely.
And so maybe that's the best option. But let's say your house is in a prime location.
Mm-hmm.
Downtown, say, I don't know, you're in Fountain Square or Cottage Hill or somewhere downtown, and you keep hearing about Airbnb.
Yes. This is one of my new favorite real estate topics, by the way.
Oh, me too. We just really took a deep dive on this, learning about it just a few months ago.
Yeah.
When we sat down with a local management company.
Yeah. That really just specializes in helping you turn your income-producing property into a short-term income-producing property. Okay? Meaning there is so much more money to sometimes be made by renting it out by the night than renting it out for the month.
Right.
And on top, and it may, maybe it sounds like a little bit more work, but the benefit is man, sometimes when you have a long-term tenant in place, you only go in that house maybe once a year just as a double check on everything if, by the way, you have that in your lease. They don't have to let you in if you don't have that written specifically in the lease. So, again, just nuanced things that a good property manager is going to be able to help you learn. But you see the property, so you can stay ahead of repairs. You can stay ahead of problems before they become major problems, because sometimes maybe a tenant doesn't tell you that their toilet's been leaking, and then all of a sudden they've got drip, 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 and after 3 months of drip, 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 now you've got mold.
Right.
Right? Whereas when you're considering something like an Airbnb, now all of a sudden you're in that house every 2 or 3 days. You've got a cleaner going in there every 2 or 3 days, or you know maybe once a month, and they're taking care of everything as it goes. So little problems don't become big problems.
Right. And so those are some of the different options. If you're getting ready to move out of a house, these are things to consider. And we can help you navigate through them. Mm-hmm. But do you want to sell? Do you want to, I call it old school, lease it? Mm-hmm. Or do you want to Airbnb it?
Yeah. Well, and you just really have to educate yourself on what's that look like for you. Okay. You have to really ask yourself some tough questions as to if this is something you can legitimately take on. If you decide to assume the role of being your own property manager, you better have some time in your schedule to allow for that, because it's not just one of those things where, my mortgage on this house is $1,000 a month and, the rental comps say I can get $1,500 a month for it. Upon initial review, that $500 a month profit looks really, really good.
Right.
But I'll tell you what, you better set aside a portion of that for capital expenditures, because that house is going to need updates. It's going to need repairs. It's going to need maintenance. And you've got to have a plan for that. You can't just take that $500 a month and go buy a brand new truck with that extra $500 a month you have coming in. You better know how to manage that money in order to make it work for you the best way it possibly can.
So what else do we need to share about this topic today?
I think we've really hit on a lot of, the pros and cons of this. I think one of the, biggest things to really consider is what's, a good real estate agent like yourself is going to be able to help you determine, is this the right thing to do? They're going to be able to help you know, okay, what can I lease this thing out for? Okay, what's the comparable, lease comp look like versus what can I sell this for and how much money would go in my pocket if I sell it right now? We're going to be able to help somebody out, a good team of people, or a good real estate agent is going to be able to help position you with maybe the right property manager. They're going to be able to help position you with the right team of contractors that can help maintain that property for you if you're not qualified to do that yourself. So, just knowing how do you find the right real estate agent, what types of services can the right real estate agent actually help you out with, either way you decide to look at this.
And so on that, I think we'll wrap up. I do have a question for you.
Maybe.
So I'm just curious. Do you know, when asked why he had the ship steering wheel for a belt buckle, what the pirate said?
I got nothing for
you. He said, "Arg, it drives me nuts."
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. There it is. Boom, boom, boom. Yeah.
All right. We can probably edit that part out, maybe. I don't know.
Good All right. Stuff. So, yeah, no, I think this is a really important topic for a lot of people to really consider, because I love real estate as a vehicle to maybe help you make some money. It's a real estate, real estate is a vehicle to help you accomplish some goals. It certainly isn't the only one. You can invest in many other, tools or vehicles to help you make money in life.
Yep.
But real estate is the one that I happen to know, like, and trust. And I know what it can do for me. And I have seen what it's done for many, many of my clients over the years. And I love it. Especially, you and I were, sitting down with the Airbnb girls, as we call them. And I mean, they really just opened my eyes as to this whole new possibility of opportunity.
Yep.
With real estate. And since then, I've met so many people that are doing extraordinarily well with properties, in the suburbs even, that come into town for work, and they don't want to rent a hotel because they want to kind of have their own little place, because they're going to be in town for a week or two for work, and they want a nice place to go home to and cook their own dinner versus having to go out every night, et cetera. So, I mean, this idea of short-term rentals, I love it. I mean, I'm truly excited about it. I've learned a lot about it over the last handful of months. So more on that to come as we move forward. But no, I think that's it for this edition of Blue Collar Real Estate, Greg.
Awesome. Well, as always, remember to subscribe, rate, review, and hit that little ding, ding
notification
bell if you're on
bell.
YouTube. Yeah.
So that way, anytime a new episode drops, we'd love to hear from you. And any other questions you guys have around this topic, if you want to explore a deeper dive or you want to, give Greg a call, he'll be more than happy to answer any additional questions, and we can get you set up with the right team of people if you do decide to keep that house or you just want to sell it. We can certainly help you out with that as well.
And so, part of that team is Stacy Mayo with the Scott Miller Group
over at Ruboff Mortgage.
They just had to throw that in at the end.
Absolutely. And again, I can't reiterate that enough, not to, just keep plugging, but it truly is all about having the right team of people around you. Anytime you're going to do anything with real estate related, you better have the right team of people, because they're going to make sure the experience is positive. And that definitely starts with Stacy and Scott over at Ruboff Mortgage.
Right on. So for this episode of Blue Collar Real Estate, I'm Greg Mayo.
And I'm Ryan Hergett.
Thanks for watching.